change my love the way that you do.
Good evening, and welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. My name is Joe LoPiccolo, your host for this week's newsletter. Since this is our first show for 1995, I'd like to wish everybody a happy and a healthy new year. And let's start off the new year right. And what is the West End Video Newsletter? Well, here we take you back in many, many years back to history of what the old West End was all about. We teach a little bit about history, a little bit about nostalgia, and a little bit about memories for those who lived in the West End. And we walk you through the West End. And the West End was a really close-knit, multi-ethnic, multi-racial community. And you don't find West Ends anymore. That was something that was lost that can never be brought back. And it was taken from us over 30 years ago under the false pretense of urban renewal. And it was a shame what they did to the people of the West End. And hopefully we'll be coming back to some new housing soon. But that's another show to be level with. But now that brings us to our first guest. And here we have a gentleman who's a very prominent West Ender, comes from a prominent West End family, and his knowledge and rich history of the West End and politics in Boston is unbeatable. And his grandparents go back, and they're original West Enders. And with that, I'd like to introduce Mr. Ed Fitzgerald. Welcome to our show, Ed.
Good evening, Joe.
Glad to see you here today.
Nice to be here.
And tell us a little about your family roots in the city of Boston and the West End back.
I would like to say I'm looking at the Mayhew School, mm-hmm. where I went to kindergarten, mm-hmm. on the corner of Poplar and Chamber Street. And in that kindergarten class was Melvin Nimoy, Leonard Nimoy's brother, mm-hmm. and many more West Enders. The Nimoys lived right across the street from the Mayhew School. But my name is Ed Fitzgerald. I was born on Allen Street, 7 Allen Street, in 1926, in the bed that I'm told I was conceived in. And I went to the Mayhew School for kindergarten, to the Blackstone School for the first, second, and third grade, to the Peter Faneuil for the fourth grade, and to the Wendell Phillips School for the fifth and sixth, and then to Boston Latin School, and from there to Boston English High School. I graduated in 1943, went into the Navy, and then to Boston College, and practiced law for a number of years, operated a parking lot, and did many other things.
Hey, Eddie, to go back even further than that, give us a little insight into your grandparents and your parents and where they came from in the West End.
Well, I understand my great-grandfather came here around 1820 during one of the potato famines. And he was the superintendent of the coal pier, which was where the old lady's home was on Embankment Road when it was a saltwater estuary where ships came in and the coal barges would unload. And he had six children, and my grandfather was the only boy. And he was born in 1850, and there was no Catholic Church in the West End at the time, so he had to go to the cathedral to be baptized. And then later years, in 1862, St. Joseph's Church, I think, was opened. Mm-hmm. And my grandfather had three children, two girls and a boy, my father. And my father had the privilege of serving in this House of Representatives, the State Senate, and the Boston City Council.
What years were those, Eddie?
I believe the first year in the House was 1915. Mm-hmm. They were one-year terms, and you ran for re-election every year. And then
does that go for all the offices?
All the
mayor,
offices,
the
governor, everybody at that time.
Oh, imagine that. One-year terms, huh?
One-year terms.
And what year was that, did you say?
Well, 1915 is when I think he first went to the House.
Wow.
And he served in the House 1915 and 1916, two terms. Then he went to the State Senate, and at that time it was almost the same as it is now. It was wards 1, 2, and 3, which was East Boston, Charlestown, the West End, North End, and South End, and wards 1 and 2 in Cambridge. Mm-hmm. And then he went back to the House of Representatives for 10 years. And in for five terms. And then in 1926, his last term in the House of Representatives, he was elected to the new 22-man council. So he served simultaneously in the council and the House of Representatives. And all during his time in the state legislature, especially in the House of Representatives, the West End always had a man on the Ways and Means Committee. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't Bart Lamassine, it was somebody else that was from the West End. Because Bart Lamassine would go to the House, then for two or three years he'd stay on the sidelines, then he'd go back, go to the Senate for a term, then go back to the House, then do this. Every few years he would go back into politics. He was served on the Board of Aldermen in the city of Boston. And
now, Martin Lamassine, he was noted as the ward boss of the West End, and he formed the Hendrix Club, they called it, and we'll get into that. But the reason why the West End was so important in those days in politics is because its location. Like we were discussing earlier, you had mentioned that it was right near the State House and right near City Hall.
It included both the State House and the City Hall in the ward lines.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Martin Lamassine, as a young man, came from what they call the Flats. He was born at 35 South Margin Street. But the Flats were considered that area, this side of what is now the Boston Garden and the North Station. Nashua Street, Billerica Street. Billerica Street was the garden street of the West End. It had trees and was known as Billerica Park. It was the place to live at that time. And Lamassine grew up in that area. Now, Martin Lamassine, his father died when he was about 13th of sunstroke. As he was walking along, I guess he just collapsed. And his mother died a short time after that. And he was brought up by a maternal aunt who spoke what they call the Irish Gaelic. And so Martin learned to speak Gaelic. And by doing that, he was able to converse with the new immigrants that came in. And he was able to steer them into his
little
way of thinking.
Mm-hmm.
So in not being able to get along with what they called the regular democratic organization in the ward, he started his own organization with his brother Joe and a fellow named Donovan. And they opened up the Hendrix Club, I think it was in 1895, somewhere in that area, at the corner of Lowell and Causeway Street. But when the Boston Elevated made that swing over to Leechmere Square, the building that he was in,
right at the curve there, that station still there, right?
So they went from there up to 11A Green Street, which was a revivalist hall where they held prayer meetings and different things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the Hendrix Club really matured and went along, and he went about the West End picking out people that he thought would be of use to him. And he was pretty lucky in what he was doing, because he selected good people that kept moving along.
And one thing you mentioned, Eddie, was in those days, the membership dues was $1
a month.
And in those days, that was a lot of money.
And you didn't have to pay dues unless you worked.
Mm-hmm.
And you either worked for the county or the city, or you had your own business, or you were an artisan or a professional person.
Mm-hmm.
And he kept that up until the last days of the Hendrix Club. The dues were still $1 a month,
mm-hmm.
and those that paid. And he limited the membership to 200 or under, because he never wanted too big a membership, because then it would get out of control and he wouldn't be able to keep the helm. But he selected lieutenants, and all his lieutenants were responsible for certain things. Now, his first, up until about when my father was a newsboy, and he delivered newspapers to Martin's house. He opened up his own newspaper store and candy and cigars on Cambridge Street, in the site of where Bob Feeney's bar was, the Marcus and Fitzgerald News, and he got to know all the people in the area around Blossom Street and where the Irish ghetto was, Cypress Street, North Anderson Street, and Bridge Court. And Martin said, well, this guy's got a pretty good group behind him. I'm going to take him under my wing.
Mm-hmm.
So my father's first job was assistant registrar of voters, outside registrar of voters that Martin had got for him. And from there, he worked along as one of his lieutenants. And then when the opportunity came, he sponsored him for the House of Representatives. And mm-hmm. if you were sponsored by Martin, it was tantamount to election. But my father had all the young, he was in charge of the young group in the West End. He had the St. Joseph's Boys Club, which was a forerunner, much before the West End House or any of the other groups, but the only fault of it was only open to Catholic boys, so you couldn't get the rest of the neighborhood.
So what we're saying is, which is not done today, is the Catholic Church in those days played a big part in politics.
They had minstrel shows. My father had the Institute, which was the Literary Institute, which was on Eaton Street, right across from the West End House, or next door to the West End House, where they prepared young boys for the fire department and the police department and mm-hmm. civil service. It was the first civil service school. And those in the West End that had got jobs and education, they all came in and gave their time to helping people. Because Martin Lamassine always was there for the poor and the downtrodden. That was his only concern in life.
Mm-hmm.
And then, as I say, Martin would, you'd go to the house with him, anyone he sponsored. He never lost a house seat until 1939, when he had died in 32, but the Hendricks Club had never lost a house seat. But he kept rotating people. As the population changed and the Jewish people started to come into prominence, he would always have a Jewish person in the House of Representatives. I think he started with Dave Mankiewicz, Robbie Robinson, Joe Rosenberg, and many more. But he had one occasion where there was a fellow named Finkelstein, who was a dentist, I think, a doctor, who said, you know, I'm going to run for representative, and I'm going to win. And Martin said, you are. He says, I'm going to run a newsboy against you, and we're going to win. So he looked around, he found a fellow named Louis Orenberg, and ran him for the House and beat Finkelstein.
Oh, wow.
Finkelstein came back and ran again, and he got beat. A few years later, Lamassine endorsed Finkelstein, and he went to the House of Representatives. But it was that he wanted to show that you couldn't win without me, and that's how he did it. And he never let people stay in the House of the Senate too long, or the Council. He rotated them, and putting himself back every few terms, because he never wanted them to get too strong.
Mm-hmm.
And he, in those days, the legislature was controlled by the Republicans, and one time he was almost elected Speaker of the House. He got, there were 90-some Democrats in the House, and he got some Republicans to pledge to him. And for 100 years, the House of Representatives always elected their Speaker by secret ballot. But the Republican leadership said, oh my God, now if we have these people vote in secret ballot, Lamassine's going to be the Speaker. So they pushed through a bill so it would be an open vote, and Lamassine was defeated. Then another time he almost won the Speakership of the House. He had the Progressive Party with him, but at the last minute, three of them departed from him, and he lost the election. But he was able in those days to turn the Republican-controlled legislature over to what he wanted overnight, because he always had so many Republicans that loved him, that he was able to maneuver.
Well, he was quite a maneuverer, and I just want to take a break for a minute, and I want to remind everybody that this is the West End Video Newsletter, and my name is Joe LoPiccolo, your host, and we're talking about politics in the West End and in the city of Boston many, many years ago, back in the 1800s and 1900s, and with us is Eddie Fitzgerald, prominent West Ender, who's taking us on a trip back in politics, and giving us an insight into what politics was in those days, and it's changed a lot now, Eddie.
Oh, it's all politics has changed. You don't have the full-time politician today. It's in those days the politician was like the parish priest. His job was to find work for people, to make sure they had enough coal to heat their house, that they had food and they had clothing, and that the kids were not abused, and they were the original social workers. But of course, Lamassine didn't like social workers. He didn't want settlement houses coming into the West End, because he felt they were too liberal. They would change the populace and would against him. That's the reason why he had my father and a few more have the boys' clubs and different things to keep them from going to the settlement houses that were progressively moving from Chicago and New York to Boston.
What years were those, would you say?
Well, when the Peabody House was the first one to come in, I would say that was prior to World War I.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, at one time, you know, all the gyms were in the West End. You had the Hecht House, the Peabody House, the Burroughs, the West End House, and the Ward Room on Blossom Street all had gyms.
You know, that was...
And
that
the
was
YMHA.
That was one of the good features of the West End, and that's what's missing today is the settlement houses and the big part and the big role they played in everybody's lives today. Those days they did.
Of course, in those days, you know, it kept the kids off the street and gave them some place to go when it was cold where they could get warm.
Mm-hmm. And it taught them respect.
It did.
It taught them life. And I remember when I belonged to the West End House and I belonged to the Peabody House, and the students from MIT and Harvard would come down to the West End House, and they'd act as counselors for us and give of their time. And that's being reinstituted today in different parts of the city. But in many, many years ago in the West End, that was a tradition that really helped us a lot.
Well, the West End had everything. You had a track down on the Charles Bank where all the Olympic runners would train, and we had Tom Burke from Allen Street, part of the Burke the Undertaking family, who was an Olympic champion. You had a fellow named Prout and a fellow named Huey McGrath that were great runners. And in those days, you had all types of athletes from the West End. They were all, they had gone to quite far, both in football. You had Joe Freno, you had in baseball. They had many good ball players that went back years ago.
Bears also had some good boxers, too.
Oh, there were a lot of boxers, because during the days of no money, that was the only way they could do it. And a fellow named Bob McCurdy and my grand aunt's husband, Bill Cuddy.
I've heard that name before.
Bill Cuddy used to put on these amateur fights, and the winner would get a watch that they'd buy back for you, because you couldn't pay an amateur. They'd sell the watch. And in fact, Bill Cuddy is called the father of amateur boxing.
Mm-hmm.
And this Bob McCurdy had a gym on Green Street, and he and my father had the first professional football team in Boston, the Boston Bulldogs. But they couldn't survive because the club teams, P.M. Marquette and Charlestown town teams and other places, used to fill Fenway Park and Braves Field with 25 and 30,000 people. And the professional team couldn't make a living. But if you look back now, as the people that came from the West End, they got their start actually through Martin Lamassini, most of them, because all the lawyers of that day wouldn't have been able to practice if the Boston Bar Association had their way, because they kept changing the requirements. And Lamassini would always put a bill in the legislature to prevent them from changing the qualifications for an applicant to the bar. They wanted to make it a high school graduate. You had to graduate from a day high school, and you couldn't be a graduate of a night high school. And he brought it back to where all you needed was 2 years of a day high school or 4 years of a night high school, and you were able to take the bar examination. Much to the chagrin of the legal elite of Boston at that time, which was Harvard Law School, who mm-hmm. had the ex, they didn't want to see the young immigrant lawyers coming in to take the business away from them. But he was way before his time in a lot of things he did. And all the time he was in the legislature, he kept them honest.
Mm-hmm. You showed me a book earlier in there, before we got on the air, and it was a book of Martin Lamassini, of his ward committee and his...
No, it was a book of people that were... See, the woman didn't have the right to vote. It was 1898. It was a list of people that were... what we would call today the census or police listing.
Mm-hmm.
And it gave the people, he would know beforehand who was there, who was ready, who was eligible to vote, and whether they were friendly to him or whether they were not friendly to him, or who he could get that would get them in line for him or whatever it was. That book was his private property. And each year he would get that book beforehand, and he'd make his own, for each year he'd make his own little references. And if you had a bad mark in that book, in the reference column, you might as well have moved out of the West End.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it amounted to. Martin Lemasnier was a very religious man, too. He, church and his family, while he was active, he would not have gambling in the West End. He wouldn't allow houses of ill fame. He tried to keep everything above board. And he would, anything could be done, but it had to be legal. Mm-hmm. If it wasn't legal, he wouldn't sanction it. But he, when you go back to the West End, you had everything. You had gyms, you had boys clubs, you had the swimming and the bibby, you had the beach, you had the proximity to the Harbor Islands, you had the proximity to the hospital and to the shopping areas of the city of Boston.
Speaking of the book,
this is the book. It's Ward 8, 1898. The inside page, it says private, ML, which meant that it was not to be used by anybody else but him. And as you go into this book, you find that this was right at the time when the Jewish people were coming into the West End. Most of them either came from Europe or they moved up from the North End, mm-hmm. which was entirely Jewish at one time. And you'll see the beginning of the Italian migration down on Pitt Street and Hale Street. And the names that you'll find in here, like Harry Lean, who later became the consul to the Cardinal, and the Sonnabend family, the big hotel people, mm-hmm. You'll find in here. And then you'll come across the beginning of, like in every street now, you'll find an Italian family, like Charlestown Street, which no longer existed.
Can we turn the book around?
Sure. And if you look on the side, you can see some of the references that Lemasnier would put beside the people that were there.
And what year was this?
1898. That was the beginning of the Hendrix Club road to success. Mm-hmm. As you know, the Hendrix Club was named after Thomas Hendrix, mm-hmm. who was a vice president under Cleveland, the vice presidential nominee with Tilden, when Tilden was elected by the popular vote but defeated by the electoral vote and by Rutherford Hayes, but came back when Cleveland was elected president. Now, the reason for the selection of that name was that Thomas Hendrix always was a fighter for the Irish cause, and Lemasnier was a great man for the Irish cause. He always tried to do things for the Irish immigrants when they came in, try to protect them from being abused and maltreated. So for that reason, that was the name Hendrix was selected.
After the Hendrix Club era and the Lemasnier era, did the Kennedys come into at that point, or was that later on?
Well, the Kennedys didn't come until 1946. Mm-hmm. Of course, the grandfather, John F. Fitzgerald, had lived in the North then, then moved to Concord and then moved to Dorchester. And when Jack Kennedy decided to run for Congress, he came into what he thought was a safe district for him. Because they had just gerrymandered the district, and Tom Elliott from Harvard College, a Cambridge fellow, was gerrymandered out. And former Governor Curley was elected to Congress, and he got into some problem, and so the seat was, he ran for mayor, was elected mayor, and then Jack Kennedy came in and campaigned in that, the 11th Congressional District, mm-hmm. which was then parts of Somerville, Charlestown, a little bit of Cambridge, and wards 1, 2, and 3. The West End had a congressman prior to that, John P. Higgins, who was one of Lemasnier's lieutenants, who later became Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
Oh, I've heard that name also, right.
And then Judge Riley from Chambers Street, he was another fellow, former Boston School Committee man that was one of Martin's proteges, too.
And you had Judge Adlow.
Adlow was elected to the House from Roxbury and Dorchester, Ward
right.
12.
But he loved the West End. He wrote some nice
he
pieces on the
West End. After, later on, he lived in Charles River Park. Mm-hmm. I think Adlow's family originally came from the North End, mm-hmm. went to Roxbury or Dorchester. But Judge Tomasello came from Poplar Street.
Right.
And of course, you have today, Santo Ruma is a judge. You have Dominic Russo is a judge.
You're sitting in East Boston.
Yep, there were quite a few people in recent years. Mm-hmm. But the Lamassine had another thing going for him in the legislature. Anyone he had there in the House would put a bill in every year to raise the judges' salaries, because he always wanted to keep the judges on his side. It's like one of my father's duties was to go up to the Boston Municipal Court every day to get the West End boys out of trouble. And then after him, someone else would be doing that.
You know, as I'm listening to you, Eddie, getting this flavor of old-time politics on the West End, you know, when you really think about it, things haven't changed that much. You still have a...
Except you don't have the full-time politician,
right.
The servant of the people. Mm-hmm.
But the method and the ways and
the ways and
tricks
and will never change, because That's the reason why the House is called an institution.
Mm-hmm.
Institutions don't change. But at one time, as I say, the West End had more people on the payroll of the city and county than anywhere else. And the amount of the salaries came to, I think, about $80,000. Compare that to the day.
Oh, gee.
You got one person you would have from the West End.
Mm-hmm.
But there was, if a person had from the West End had a job anywhere in the county or city, and he died, that job had to be filled by a West Ender.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they perpetuated their existence.
Mm-hmm. And Lamassine was in the back of all of this.
All of it. He was
the
strategist.
Warpus,
he was
right.
The mastermind. He's been known Lincoln Steffens, all the big writers will all tell you that he was probably the brightest man they ever met, and he went to the fifth or sixth grade in school.
You're kidding.
No, fifth and sixth grade. I think he left in the sixth grade.
Right, and those?
Most people did, like my father graduated from the Phillips Grammar School, and that mm-hmm. was the sixth grade. In those days, as Martin said, it isn't what you know, it's how you use it.
That's what I was going to ask you. We're coming near the end of the show now, and I would want to give us some good quotes from Martin Lamassine, and that's one of them.
Well, he had a lot of good quotes. Don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing.
Mm-hmm.
And don't go to any banquets or weddings or anything else, because you may get into trouble and say something that you didn't want to say.
Yeah, yeah.
Or promise something that you couldn't fulfill.
Mm-hmm.
And he was, as I say, he didn't have a family. He lived on McLean Street at the end. He had a brother, Joe, who was married.
Mm-hmm.
But he enjoyed family people. I remember my first occasion to meet him, I was 6 years old. And it was in the Hendricks Club on Chamber Street, 62 Chamber Street.
6 years old.
6 years old. I remember I went over to see my father, and he promptly rushed me out of there.
Oh, wow.
And it was that day that James Roosevelt came in to talk to Mart Lamassine about endorsing his father for President of Franklin Delano Roosevelt for the presidency of the United States.
Wow, and that's how that all got started, too.
Yeah. Well,
gee, this has been a great show, and we've brought you right back into Boston politics down the road, and into the history and insight of what Boston politics and West End politics was all about. And we enjoyed having our guest here, Ed Fitzgerald. I thank you very much for being part of our show and bringing your history into everybody's living room. And I hope everybody enjoyed the show, and Happy New Year, and we'll see you at the next West End Video Newsletter. Good evening.
Out of mind. Change my love the way that you do.